Actually, you still have just one Hey. Welcome back. So, alongside Chris Harrison.
I'm Johnson. You're Harrison.
I'm Harrison.
That's right.
Getting punchy, a little late. All right. In any event, we've teased it long enough. I think it's time to finally get into apps, so let's have at it.
Excellent, excellent. This is really what I would call the meat and potatoes of today's topics, right? We're going to talk about the new SharePoint app model. So just a little bit of an intro. First, we're going to do an overview of apps for SharePoint for those who've never heard of the SharePoint app model before. What it does, how it kind of works, what problems it attempts to solve over the previous models of development with SharePoint. And then we're going to get in and take a look at developing apps for SharePoint and some of the choices and so forth that that you have when you're considering this as a particular option. Okay, so first up, we're going to take a look through what is a SharePoint app. We're going to talk about the different types and how they're hosted, the different hosting models, I guess, for want of a better word there, where things are hosted and located at, the tools and the things that you're going to need to develop apps, a little bit of the guts of an app about how it's sort of how it runs under the covers around what we call host web and app webs and remote webs and what those things all mean and how it interacts with SharePoint. But first up, what is a SharePoint app? So in the previous world of SharePoint development, we talked about full trust or farm solutions, and we also mentioned some of the issues that brings up around adding code into the SharePoint application space or process. And so what the concept behind a SharePoint app is really about this idea of extracting out the code and so forth that you write and running it outside of the SharePoint app. Right. Outside of the SharePoint process itself. And so that could be hosted in what we call a cloud-hosted app, where the code in the background runs off in some other service or system. Or it could be a more simple app that runs entirely on the client front end, which we call a SharePoint-hosted app. So those are those two models. But underpinning all of this were the design goals of what the app model is really all about. The idea here is that Office 365 is going to be a popular choice moving forward for those who want to host and run their SharePoint, or sorry, have somebody else host SharePoint for them and run their SharePoint sites off in the cloud. It's obviously provided by Microsoft, but the app model was designed to be ubiquitous across both on-prem and in the cloud.
Right.
Whereas full trust and farm solutions only run on-prem. The app model is applicable in both of those scenarios, potentially, depending on if it's the right choice for your solution. It never runs within the SharePoint host environment, so we don't have those problems of code taking down the SharePoint process, that kind of thing that that we've had in the past as well. Now, the way a SharePoint app interacts with SharePoint is really threefold. I like to boil it down to these three main areas. The first is how it connects with SharePoint's user interface. So where the app surfaces inside your sites. So that could be something like an app part that you alluded to in the previous modules, which is kind of the equivalent of a web part in the app model. Or it could be through, say, a custom action menu, a menu item in the custom action bar on a document, for example, or maybe a button in the ribbon. So those are all UI integration points. The second is how you get access to data and operations. So that's the second kind of integration bucket that I'd like to talk about. And that's all about using REST and the client-side object model to get access to data that exists in SharePoint or to push data into SharePoint or to make operations on SharePoint's, say, sites or libraries or what have you. And then the third is typically, the third category I like to point out typically is how SharePoint tells you when stuff happens inside of a site. So we talked about event receivers early on.
Right.
The equivalent of what's called remote event receivers in the app model allows SharePoint to tell your backend code, if you're using a provider-hosted app, which we'll talk about in a minute, that something's happened in SharePoint. Say a document got added to a document library.
Right.
So we've got UI integrations, data integrations, and event integrations. Those are really the three main sort of integration points. then the next thing comes is, so you go build your app. Then how do you get stuff, how do you get those apps into SharePoint? That's obviously really important. And again, there are options here. There are, for the folks that are building apps for their organization that have no intention of ever needing to give those apps to other people, then you can do what we call sideloading an app into what's called an app catalog in SharePoint. And that app catalog exists either in Office 365, you can create one, or you can create an app catalog on-prem as well. And so that gives you the ability to upload an app, put it in this app catalog, make it available to sites in SharePoint, and people can install that app on their site.
Yep.
The other option that we also talked about a little earlier on is being able to package that app up, and publish it in the Office marketplace, Office and SharePoint marketplace. And so that's more like an app store that you're used to with a phone application, for example, or something like that, where you can go and purchase an app and install it on your site.
Right, exactly.
So you've got those two options for putting it out there to folks.
Yep.
If we take a look at the hosting model behind how SharePoint apps work, it's really split up into those two categories of apps that I mentioned before, what we call a SharePoint hosted app, where all of the assets, the code, the scripts, the imagery, the style sheets, and so forth, it's all inside the app. There's no back-end code behind, no compiled code. That's all contained within the SharePoint app. And when you add one of those to your SharePoint site, those assets get deployed into a what we call an app web or in SharePoint, and all of those assets go in there. Whereas the other category of apps is what we call cloud-hosted apps. These are apps that have code behind, and compiled code potentially, but they also may consist of those same assets that SharePoint hosted apps have, but the backend runtime runs somewhere else. There's actually a couple of subcategories of these types of apps that we'll talk about in a little bit. So basically, in summary, for the hosting types of apps, we've got the SharePoint hosted apps that I mentioned, where everything runs on the client, the assets are deployed into SharePoint. Auto-hosted apps are a subcategory of cloud-hosted apps.
Right.
And so are remote-hosted apps, or what I like to call provider-hosted apps. Now, those two app categories are interesting. Auto-hosted apps are apps where you package your code, your assets, maybe a database along with it, and you give it to SharePoint and you say, go load this app.
Mm-hmm.
And then Microsoft and Office 365 take care of loading that app for you. They take the back-end code, they automatically push it into Azure and start hosting it for you. As a developer, that's kind of out of your control at that point. So Microsoft are responsible for running the Azure piece. You don't get any sort of access to that Azure tenant to go and see how your app's running. And each client that installs your app gets a different instance of that app running in Azure.
And that's a great advantage that tenant or each client that's installed your app will get their own separate section. Because when we get into remote hosted apps, the big thing that we're going to see is that it's our servers, it's our database, and in turn, it's our responsibility to make sure that everybody stays separated. Mm. When we do our auto hosted, every time that somebody new installs the app, there's automatically a brand new environment created, a brand new environment to run our code, a brand new instance of the database. Everything is automatically separated for us. So that way we don't have to worry about that. We don't have to worry about making sure that everybody's separate. And then also on the same token, we don't have to worry about things as much when it comes time to upgrade. That if we're hosting all the code, we need to remember which version everybody is on. On the flip side, if we're doing an auto-hosted app, if somebody upgrades, it's just going to upgrade their little spot. We don't have to worry about dealing with versioning.
Correct.
It makes our lives a lot easier.
It is a little easier, and there are pros and cons of anything,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely, yeah.
So with auto-hosted apps, like I said, Microsoft takes care of hosting the back end of the code for you. You don't have access to that Azure tenant. You can't just dive in there and do any sort of tweaking or debugging on the fly, those sorts of things. So Microsoft takes care of that stuff. Also, the other caveat I would say with auto-hosted apps are, although you can build and deploy them today,
mm-hmm.
you can't put them in the store yet. So Microsoft hasn't turned on accepting, as far as I'm aware, has not turned on accepting auto-hosted apps yet.
Yet.
So
that
you
is
can,
the operative word.
You can build them, you can compile your code, you can package them up as an app, you can deploy them into your own SharePoint Online tenancies, but you can't stick them in the store for other people to buy. Yet. Stay tuned. Maybe. So, remote-hosted apps or provider-hosted apps, as they're also commonly called, vary a little bit in that the back end of the Azure components, you have to host yourself.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't also, we should caveat at this point, it doesn't have to be Azure. So the back end code could, I mean, the first and best experience through all of the tooling that Microsoft gives developers for dealing with Azure projects and so forth, it's by far and away the easiest to do it on Azure.
Right.
Just because of the developer tools and that process. However, there's nothing to go stop you sticking it on Heroku with Ruby if you really, really like stabbing yourself with pencils in the face. But
wow.
I highly recommend trying the, while you're learning this stuff at least, doing it in Azure first. All okay. the tooling helps you immensely. And let's talk a little bit about that. So, in terms of the tools and technologies about these apps, you spoke about the JavaScript object mm-hmm. model just now.
Yep.
And the client-side technologies, I think we've covered that pretty well.
Yep.
In the last module. In terms of the server-side technologies, I love the new app model because of what it allows developers to do now that we couldn't do in the past. So I used to work on the SharePoint team once upon a time, and the number of times I got asked by developers, when am I going to be able to build my SharePoint solution using MVC?
Mm-hmm.
Or when am I going to be able to build my SharePoint solution using .NET, insert the latest version that SharePoint wasn't running on here?
Yes.
I think back in the days we were on 3 or something along those lines.
Yeah, it was 3.5
was coming out.
Yeah, yep.
It got real painful. And so SharePoint development was always kind of one step behind where the rest of the ASP.NET stack or Microsoft stack of dev tools were at.
Right.
And apps, and in particular provider-hosted apps, open that up a lot more. We can do MVC, we can do Razor, and all these things that are not that new, but they're new for SharePoint developers.
Right.
Which is really, really great.
And, you know, the simplest thing is, I mean, it really just, it allows developers to be developers, that it's going to build upon your strengths. So if you are a Ruby on Rails developer, if you are a PHP developer, you want to keep using really any technology that you're used to, you now have that capability that you're not limited to just doing web forms development. You're not limited, frankly, to just doing .NET, that you can use whatever environment it is that that you want. And then also going forward into the development environment, you're going to notice that you can, of course, do your development with Visual Studio 2012. And if you haven't already played with it, it's definitely something that's worth looking at, which is Napa, to go in and create your applications.
Yeah, Napa is a really interesting tool. So it's available for everybody with a Office 365 subscription. You don't download anything. You go in, you can create a developer site up in Office 365.
Yep.
And it's also worth pointing out at this point that if you don't have an Office 365 tenant today, it's very straightforward to go up to the Microsoft site and sign up for a trial.
Right.
You can get a 30-day trial with everything you need all boxed in there. Go create yourself a developer
mm-hmm.
site collection and start going to town on app development.
Yep.
And so if you go create a developer site, you can go and add Napa. You'll find it in the store. It's a free app. Go and add it to your site, and it's a full in-browser SharePoint-hosted app development tool. All done in the browser. You write all your code, HTML, JavaScript, all that sort of stuff. It's pretty interesting. Also, if you need to upsize at that point, you can download the solution and import it into Visual Studio and carry on your development there as well.
Awesome.
Very cool tool.
One of the biggest things that we've been talking about is the separation that we've got SharePoint and we've got our apps, that our apps are not allowed to run inside of SharePoint. So if we kick over to my slide right here, what you're going to notice is that we have two big breakdown here, breakdowns, which is our host webs and our app webs. For me, when I made the move into apps, this was probably the hardest thing for me to get my head around because I was just so used to, I create a list, that's inside my SharePoint site, I go in, I work with my data, and away I go. And that really changes when it comes to apps, that if you go in and you just add on a brand new instance and you create your bit of JavaScript to go ahead and run, what you're going to notice is that when you deploy that out, you're going to see a page, you're going to be able to access all that data, But none of that's actually inside of the normal SharePoint environment. That instead, that's inside of your host web. So going back to this separation, we're going to have, at a bare minimum, two separate webs that we're going to have our host web, and that's where the user actually went in and installed the application. And there's going to be created an app web, and the app web is going to be the default location for all of our data. The two great advantages to having that app web, number one, is I'll always have permissions, that from inside the app I can always do essentially whatever it is that I want to the app web. That's my sandbox, that's my place to play. But also number two, when we go to remove this app, it's sort of just like deleting a folder, that all we have to do is just go in, delete the app web, and away we go. That's all that we need. Now, if you are going to be doing remote hosting, you'll then have, you know, your application over there. And so that might be hosted inside of Azure, that might be Ruby on Rails, whatever it is that that you might be interested in. And so from there, I'll be able to work with a database or do whatever it is that that I might need to do. Now, down at the very bottom here, what you're going to notice is a really, 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 really long URL. And that URL is the location of our app web. Now, starting from the tail end here, what you're going to notice is apps.contoso.com. And by the way, since we are doing a Microsoft presentation, we are required to mention Contoso at least 14 times.
Dan Jumper's my favorite CEO, after all.
Yes, absolutely, yep. Absolutely. And we also have to mention Northwind, which I'm very disappointed we waited till now to finally do that. So there we go. So that's the first main component, is we will need a domain setup to host all of our apps. And SharePoint's going to need to be configured to put all of the apps inside of that domain. There's a little bit of work that needs to be done inside of SharePoint. There's a little bit of work that needs to be done inside of DNS as well. If you fire up Bing, you'll be able to find all sorts of MSDN articles, blog posts, and otherwise that will walk you through all the steps that need to be done inside of DNS and inside of SharePoint to get this up and running. But this is something that you'll either need to do on your own development environment, or eventually when you go to deploy this out, that your administrator will need to set up.
Yeah, it's also probably worth noting that the reason why an app is hosted on such an odd URL and not just on your regular site is because of security concerns like cross-site scripting attacks,
right?
Or having somebody else's JavaScript that you've downloaded from the store being able to get access to any data in your SharePoint environment. If it was running on the same domain, then the JavaScript could call into other areas of SharePoint on that same domain and get access to data. And so the reason why you have an app web like this, mm-hmm, is it's on a different domain, and so that the browsers then protect against against cross-site scripting attacks and stopping the JavaScript from getting access to that data it shouldn't get access to.
Exactly. And really, in addition, when you stop and think about it, the whole goal of an app is to be able to access this from the SharePoint site. That the whole goal is not to just go to the website. I mean, if that was the goal, well, then just build an application and go from there. There's no sense in doing apps at that point. The whole goal is, let's access this from inside of SharePoint. Now, bring it back down to our URL. The one part that we will get control over is that little prefix that's right there. And that's where we can identify the prefix for every single installed app that we want. And then finally, last but not least, is that little app ID there, which is going to be generated uniquely for each time that the application is installed. One of the big components about apps that we really didn't mention earlier is the fact that we can apply permissions not only to individual users, but now with apps, we can apply permissions to apps as well. So we can control what it is that they are and aren't allowed to do inside of our environment, and the way that they're going to be identified is based on that ID. Now, what can our apps do? Well, again, we can have our app parts, which are basically just web parts just hosted inside of an app. We can have our start page to create an immersive experience, which is what we'll be demoing here in just a few minutes. And then last but not least is we can add on our own custom commands as well. So if there's maybe some processing of items or files or otherwise that you want to be able to do inside of your app, you can add in the appropriate button. You can add it into the little edit window to send your item off to there. Now, one big challenge in particular with any form of a cloud-hosted app is making sure that the app looks, smells, tastes, and feels just like the environment that it's running in. And of course, it could be running who knows where. And this is where the Chrome control comes into play, that the Chrome control makes it easier for me to inherit the style from the host web app. And we'll actually talk a bit more about that and see a demo of that in the next module. Now, how can we access data? Well, first of all, we can access data using the APIs that we've already discussed, that we can use the client-side object model, we can use the REST APIs like we normally have. The big question, though, is where is our data? And if our data is inside the app web, we're good, we're fine, we don't need to do any special authentication or anything else. But if it's inside the host web, then we will need to authenticate, we will need to ask for permissions to be able to work with data that's inside of that, that host web. Now, as far as data that's outside of SharePoint, we can call web services. Or if we are running a cloud-hosted app where we're going to have access to the .NET object model, we can then do whatever it is that we want. So if we do want to use a SQL database, if we do want to use a MySQL database, if we do want to use that O database, whoever that company is, we can go in and do that with our cloud-hosted apps. Now, you're going to notice when we get in and actually do our little bit of code here, you are going to notice that apps are going to be relatively similar to things that you've seen in the past. That if you've ever done any form of a solution, this really kind of just extends upon that. That instead of having the Wisp extension, it's going to have the .app extension. And inside of there, it's going to have our manifest. It's going to have the solution file. So there is still a Wisp file. It's going to have the icon that's going to be displayed out when a user goes to actually add in our app. And if we're doing an auto-hosted app, there's also a data tier app package that needs to be there. The reason for that is when we set up an auto-hosted app, remember that that's going to be done inside of Azure with Office 365. So somebody installs it, and poof, it's going to create a brand new environment. And that's going to include the database. So if we are going to do a database, we need to know how to set up that database, and that's where that data tier app package comes into play. Okay. With all that, let's actually get in and start doing things. And there's a couple of things that we want to highlight. First of all, you are going to notice that we do have inside Visual Studio the different templates that we can choose from. We'll go in and take a look at that here in just a second. One little thing that I do want to mention before I get in and do my app is if you are trying to make calls to or from the remote environment, we do have a little bit of a problem here. That one of the things that Chris mentioned earlier is this concept of a cross-site script attack. And when you really stop and think about it, making all the different JavaScript calls that we're going to be making are really actually just cross-site scripting all over the place. Because if I ever make a call into that host web, I'm now executing JavaScript from a different domain and trying to access something inside of SharePoint. And if I'm executing JavaScript and I'm trying to access some remote service, again, I'm just doing cross-site scripting all over. So if we are going to be making any form of cross-domain calls, you will notice that we have the ability to register all of those calls in advance and be able to properly make those without having to deal with the cross-scripting issues. That if, in particular, I want to access the app web from JavaScript inside of a remote web, that's where my cross-domain library comes into play. On the flip side, if I'm trying to access anything from inside of SharePoint from the remote web, that's where my web proxy comes into play. All right, you know what? Enough talking.
Let's go take a look at some code.
Yeah, let's actually do something.
Excellent,
here.
Excellent.
All right, so let me bring up, I had my remote desktop connection a couple of minutes ago. Wait for my system to come back to life.
Do you want me to start singing elevator music? No.
No. No. No.
Not a good scene.
No. No. Okay. Again, if you could sing Jenny, that'd be great. It's a Flight of the Conchords song. Flight of the Conchords is a band from New Zealand. So, in any event.
Present.
Yes. Okay. So let's go back and take a look at the little app that that we had before. And what I want to do is I want to open up my little web part here, and I'm going to open up my ASCX file. Now, this is exactly what we had before with really just one addition here, that when you actually create a movie now, I added on a brand new method here called display movies. And so when you add in a movie, and we call that success method that we had from before, what we're going to do is we're going to go load all the data from that list. And so that's where our get items SP camel query comes into play. We're going to load up all the movies, and we're going to display them out. And so you're going to notice that we're going to loop through all the items. Now, we don't have a for each here, but what you're going to notice is that we will be able to do the get enumerator to actually loop through everything. And your bit of .NET trivia for the day, that for each actually compiles to, behind the scenes, a call to get enumerator and a while loop from there to actually loop through everything.
Gotcha.
So,
gotcha.
Yeah.
There you go. You learn something about languages every day.
Yep. There you go. Okay, so the way that the enumerator works is that there's move next and get current. That what move next will do is it will try to move to the next item, to the next item, to the next item. Once we're out of items, it will then just return false. And then get current will get me my current item. Now, if you remember from before, we don't have properties, so I can't just simply go grab the title directly. So that's where we have get item, title. I'm going to add on a line break to the end, and then I'm going to put that into my movies output div tag.
Gotcha.
So this is a very very expansive display here, you know, very, very complex. So just our little break tags to go between each one. Okay, so let me just go ahead and deploy this out. Deploying, deploying, deploying. Activating.
Cool. So this is similar to deploying a farm solution, what you're seeing here, right? You're effectively, you know, taking your code, packaging it up, mm-hmm. and pushing it out to the SharePoint site. However, it's slightly different this time.
Well, it's still the same, because I've still got my sandbox solution.
Gotcha. Still in the sandbox.
Still in the sandbox.
Correct. Okay. Correct.
So what I want you to notice right here is I'm going to go in and set up my little system right here. And let's go with Now You See Me, which I saw on the plane the other day. It was a decent movie. Nothing great. If you're a Magic fan, it's probably worth a watch. But outside of that, I don't know that I would necessarily say, hey, go see it. But, you know. In any event, it was a good way to kill a couple
hours. Go see Gravity instead. There you go.
I've heard great things about that, so need to see that. In any event, let me go ahead, add in my movie, and you'll notice that sure enough, it displays out Now You See Me. Now, I also just want to bring up the movies list here real quick, and once again, I want to highlight Now You See Me. All right, so there's our movies list, and we've already seen the sandboxed solution little web part that we've got.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yep. Cool. Now, let's go back over here to our little environment here, and I'm going to say add new project and app for SharePoint 2013, and I'm going to say app for movies because I'm very creative with my naming. So that's what we're going to use here. All right. Now, when I do this, it's immediately going to ask me a couple very basic little questions. It's going to ask me, well, what's the name of the app? And so, of course, it's going to give me app for movies. And let's say app for movies. There we go. And it's going to ask me what site I want to deploy this out to. And all of that's kind of your standard, typical, hey, we're going to create, well, anything inside of Visual Studio for SharePoint. Where do we want to put this out to? So there you go. But what's different, of course, is down here at the very bottom where it asks, how do you want to host your app for SharePoint? And so you'll notice right here that it asks, all right, do you want auto-hosted, do you want provider-hosted or remote-hosted, or do you want SharePoint-hosted? And again, the difference is that with auto-hosted, that's going to be Office 365. provider hosted. That's where we're going to create our own server to run code. And then SharePoint hosted, that is all browser, all JavaScript, all the time. And so for right now, I'm going to start off by doing SharePoint hosted apps. Now, before I hit finish here, let's also highlight real quick this little item right here. Sign up for an Office 365 developer site to develop an app for SharePoint. If you are doing client-side development, if you're doing JavaScript, you don't need to have SharePoint installed. If you're doing server-side object model, you must have SharePoint installed wherever it is that you're doing your work. But now, we don't need this. And this is yet another great advantage to doing app development. I don't know if you guys have noticed, but the requirements for setting up a dev server for SharePoint are relatively great. That the recommended amount of memory on there...
Big way, not in a great way.
Yes, exactly. Great isn't big, yes. That the recommended amount of RAM, if you are going to be hosting every single service on your development box, is 24 gigs.
Great. Yeah. Scott, man.
1.21 gigawatts. So yeah. it's going to be a very high bar to try and clear.
Right.
With doing apps, I just need to be able to install Visual Studio.
You got Visual Studio, you can go get yourself an Office 365 tenancy, and booyakasha, you're in business.
Booyakasha?
Yep.
Okay.
That's an LEG thing.
Okay.
Anywho.
All right. So, most of these references are really just for our own enjoyment. Okay. Waiting, creating project. Okay. Now, let's first of all highlight a couple of very big items that have been set up in here. First of all, you're going to notice that there is a default ASPX file that has been created. And this is going to be my start page. And every app that I'm going to build is going to need some form of a start page. What that start page does is completely up to you. Now, for those of you who have worked in the past with SharePoint development and you see pages, what you might be thinking at this point is, oh, I'm creating an application page. And you're not. You are not creating an application page. This ASPX page will be uploaded into that SharePoint environment as part of your app. It is not needing to be deployed out to the SharePoint root. So this is not the typical app page that you're thinking of when you're doing SharePoint development. The next little item that I want to highlight is the app.js file. And the app.js file is the root of all the JavaScript that we're going to be working with. So that's where I'm going to start. So all the calls that I want to make and so forth, all of that's going to go into app.js. Now, you can, of course, go in and add in all the other JavaScript files that that you might need, that you might want. App.js is there to be the starting point, the entry point for our application. In addition, down below, you're going to notice that we have... Can I have a drum roll? No, don't do it. All right. In any event, no segue possible. You're going to notice that we have jQuery built right in. So going back to something that we've been talking about quite a bit, that you know we weren't allowed to play with the cool kids as SharePoint developers, now we are able to play with the cool kids that you'll actually notice that we've got jQuery that's built right in. The last little item that I want to highlight is this references.js file. Doing JavaScript development is a little bit of a challenge sometimes because of the fact that JavaScript is just so flexible. I mean, that really, in order to truly understand what it is that an object can do, you almost just have to run all the code and let's see what happens on the other side. That being said, the IntelliSense that we get now with JavaScript in Visual Studio 2012 and really continuing on into 2013, I think is nothing short of remarkable, nothing short of revolutionary. It does an amazing job. It does behave a little bit differently for those of you making the move from C#. You'll notice that if you go to hit that little paren where normally it would automatically finish out the method, that doesn't happen. So you will have to just get yourself into the habit of hitting tab and away you go from there. But even then, everything that it does for you is truly nothing short of remarkable. The one catch is I've got to help JavaScript out, I have to help Visual Studio out a little bit. And that's where that references JS file comes into play. That inside of here is the reference to all of the different JavaScript files that we're going to be working with. So all the different libraries that you might download, be it Knockout, be it jQuery UI, be it whatever it is, if you just add the reference into there, that is what's going to enable your IntelliSense. For those of you who've done maybe 2010, and in the past you did the not defined constant to go ahead and get your IntelliSense, we're not needing that now. That now we just simply go into the references and away we go.
And this is a Visual Studio thing, right? This is not a SharePoint thing.
Correct. This is a Visual Studio thing. This is not a SharePoint thing. You're absolutely right. Okay. So let me just go ahead and close that out. And now let's focus in on the page here. Now, if you take a look at the page that we've got, this looks very much like a normal SharePoint page. That you'll notice that it's actually inheriting from Webpart page. You'll notice that we've got the couple of normal placeholders. So you'll notice right there, there's the additional page head. You'll notice right there, there's our placeholder page title in title area. So let's go ahead and say app for movies. And then down below, you'll notice placeholder main. Now again, if you've done a normal page, this is very familiar to you. If you never have, here's all that you really need to know. All your HTML is going to go right into there. Now, let's go take a look at our app.js file. So let me load up app.js here, real quick, double click. And what you're going to notice with app.js is they've already got built in our Hello World. Now, up at the top, you'll notice use strict. We've already mentioned, JavaScript is very flexible, and it's also a little bit funky at times. That one of the problems that we have with JavaScript is scoping. That there is no scoping down to, say, like your if statements and so forth. That what will wind up happening is that will actually be pushed up into your functions. On top of that, JavaScript, of course, isn't truly object-oriented. And so it's very easy to wind up with variables that are declared in the wrong scope, that, again, JavaScript trying to be flexible, that maybe I've forgotten to declare a variable, and there's all sorts of different things that can wind up going wrong. This is where use strict comes into play, that what use strict is it will look for a lot of different common types of errors, like you forgot to declare a variable, and it will fail out right away for you. Best practice is to enable use strict, and all you have to do inside your JS file is just simply put that right up at the very top, just string literal use strict, Bob's your uncle, away you go from there. Now, the next little bit of code that they've got here is they've got the load of the context, and they're going and grabbing the current user, and they're just using normal CSUM for that. So now, you're going to notice that there's the document.ready. Now, I'm going to make one little change before I deploy this out.
There you go.
That's the cool kid shortcut way of doing that in jQuery.
Nice.
That will be the document ready. So that will wait till everything is loaded up.
So the important part is here is when your app loads, right, you don't want this JavaScript to just start firing before everything's done and dusted.
Yep.
You want to wait till the page is loaded, all the components are loaded, then you want that JavaScript to kick off automatically. In the last example you gave, you waited until they clicked on a button. But this case, it's just going to fire this JavaScript as soon as the page is loaded and everything's good to go.
And that's exactly it.
Excellent.
Yep. So you'll notice that it's going to call a little helper function here, get username. There's our get username where it's actually going to do the load, going to do our execute query async, and then you'll notice our onGetUser success, onGetUser fail, and then down at the very bottom, you'll notice that on the success, it's going to go find that ID and let me do a little side-by-side action here. There we go. Scroll down. And what you're going to notice is right there, ID equals message. That will go ahead and bind that up for me. And it's going to print out our little hello and then user get title. All right. You know what? Let's start there, just because you know we're teaching developers, so we are legally obligated to do "Hello World" as many times as possible. So, let me go ahead and deploy this out. And you are going to notice that this is going to take it a few moments, that what it's going to do is side-loading that app. So unlike the traditional way of loading this where I'd actually add this into the app catalog, this is basically just going to shove it right into our environment. Again, in order for that to work, we either need to have the developer feature activated or we need to be using the developer template for our site. Okay, so let's come back over to here. And I'm going to do a real quick refresh. And actually, let's go back to our homepage here. Working on it. And what you're going to notice is that there's my normal page. Down at the very bottom is our apps and testing list. And that shows me all of our different apps. And you'll also notice right over here that we've got our link to our apps for movies. Now, when I click on this, what this did is... There we go. And let me zoom on in here. Is this automatically routed me to my environment? So you'll notice that there's our apps. That's the prefix that I put in. There's the ID for the app, that 3D8, you can read the rest.
3D8CE.
Yep. Yeah, yep. Exactly. And then you'll notice down at the end here that there is our Geek Trainer Apps domain. And again, that's just my internal domain, and that's what's hosting all of my apps. Then you're going to notice there's the title, App for Movies, Pages, Default. Now, one other thing that's worth highlighting here is, and I'm just going to slide a little bit over. Yeah, I'm not going to be able to get it all up into there. You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to fire that up in Notepad. I like that on Run, I had IIS reset as the last thing that I put inside of there.
Notepad, the IDE of champions.
Yes, exactly. And I'm just trying to break this down a little bit here, just so we can kind of see what's being passed in. All right. There really is two main items that I want to highlight inside of this query string. When we're doing our development, we're going to need to know where the app web is, and we're going to need to know where the host web is. And in particular, if we're doing any form of cloud-hosted apps, we're going to need to be able to determine which is which. This is where these two parameters of SP host URL and SP web app web URL come into play. That these will tell our cloud-hosted apps or our JavaScript where each spot is. So if I need to make a reference into the host URL, if I need to make a reference explicitly into the app web URL, you'll notice that I've got that built right in. So that's gotcha. Being passed along.
So that means you get to know what your context is, right?
From exactly.
Where your app is installed.
Exactly. And running.
And running.
Yep. Yep.
Gotcha.
Okay. And so now what you'll notice is, sure enough, there is my, hello, Christopher Harrison. We're just being cut off slightly on the edge there, or at least it's being cut off on my monitor over here, so I'm just going to make that look a little bit better. Oh, okay, they can? Okay, cool. We're now back down in a little window. But in any event, what you're going to notice is, sure enough, it does, in fact, do our hello, Christopher Harrison. All right. Let's enhance this. The biggest point that I kept trying to make throughout a lot of this morning and even into this afternoon is this builds on information that you already know. That again, if you're coming from 2010, you've done server-side object model, cool, you've got the client-side object model. If you've been doing JavaScript, cool, you've got REST. And again, going in and setting up all of our different list templates and so forth. We've done all of that this morning. Here's what I want to do is I want to convert that into an app. So I'm going to come over here to my little app, and on my data structure, I'm going to control click, and I'm going to highlight my movie description, and my movies. So my movie is my content type. My movie description was the special little column that I created, and my movies is that list. So I'm going to take all three of those, a real quick copy, and let me actually just make sure that that took... right click, copy, and a right click and a
paste.
Cool.
Say it ain't so.
It is so.
That's pretty cool.
So just like that, we took all the work that we did earlier, and we just pasted that right in. And this is yet another advantage to doing work declaratively. And trust me, I know, I've been there. I've felt your pain. Doing this in prior versions of Visual Studio was a challenge at best. And now it's just so much easier. So if you haven't been doing this in the past, now's a great time to get yourself in and start doing it. And you'll notice that we can now put that right into our app.
Yeah, so you've copied it from your sandbox solution,
yep,
and pasted it straight into your app project.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Now what I'm going to do is, let me just collapse all that away, and I'm going to go into my little movies web part here, and I'm going to grab just our amazingly robust UI there. Yep.
Two box, excellent.
Yep.
Input fields and button.
Exactly. Yep. And so let's go ahead and copy that. Let's get rid of everything that they've got right there and let's paste it in. So all that I did is I just simply took the UI that we already had and I put this into our default ASPX page. So this is our start page, this is our landing page. So we just put that right inside of there. Last but not least is my JavaScript. And you're gonna notice I don't need those stinking script references that I had before. I'm just simply going to copy all the script that I had from before, copy that, and let's paste that into our app.js file. And in fact, let me just...
So you could stick that JavaScript in the app.js file, or you could stick it in the actual page itself, correct?
I could stick that into the actual page itself.
Best practice.
Yeah.
Split it all up nicely for caching and all that stuff.
Exactly. And, yeah. Yep.
Gotcha.
Cool. So there is all of our code. So I haven't done anything different. That I took everything that we had from before, pasted that in. So what you're going to notice is that I've got my little variable right there, my submit button. It's going to be wired up to our click event. And you're going to notice that I've got our success. I've got our display movies. I really should rename that. Let's call it created movie. There we go. And down at the very bottom, I've got my display movie. So again, everything that we had from before.
Gotcha.
Okay. So now, right click, deploy.
Uninstalling app, pulling it back out, putting it back in. Visual Studio knows how to go get rid of your old version of your app and
yep,
put in the new version. Nice.
Waiting. There we go. Cool. So now, what you're going to notice is if I have refresh here, I'm going to get an error. And the reason that I'm going to get an error here is because the prior app is now gone. That part of this whole process is it retracted it and it put the app back in. So that URL that we had from before, all of that is now gone. And so now what we want to do is we want to head back to our intranet site. Working on it. And let's go ahead and hit up our apps for movies there. And now you're going to notice that we've got our cool little page. So let me go ahead and add in a...
Goonies.
Please
do the Goonies.
There we go, Goonies. Why can I not think of this stinking dance? The chunk.
The something shuffle. The truffle shuffle.
There we go.
Wonderful.
Perfect. All right, so now let's go ahead and add that movie in. And sure enough, just like before, it's now displaying out our Goonies. Now,
where'd that go?
That's a great question. Let's kick back here to Visual Studio for just a moment, okay? And let's sort of review what we've done. What we've done over the last couple of demos, and yeah, I'll be able to get that onto one screen, but barely. Down here at the very bottom, you're gonna notice there was our data structure demo. Movies, and you're going to notice right up there, there's our movies.
Yeah.
Cool. So when we deployed out our data structure, we created a list and we called it movies. Well, when we deployed out our app, we created a list and we called it movies.
Yes.
Uh-oh. Because dun, dun, really, dun. Yes, dramatic effect there. That should have caused a conflict. But remember what we were talking about before, that the big thing that we've been talking about in the past is we've got our two separate environments, that we've got our app web and we've got our host web. So when we deployed that out, it put all of that into our host web and, sorry, strike that, into our app web and not into our host web.
So, correct, yeah. So you've got the same definitions for the lists and columns and all that stuff, but it's deployed them into the app web.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And as a perfect little side-by-side example, and I'm just going to use the snap feature, and Windows 7 was my idea. If you take a look at my two little environments, over there on the left is my app, over there on the right is my web, and I just want to open up that movies list. So over on the right, we've got the host web. And you'll notice that we've got Now You See Me. Over on the left side, you're going to notice that we've got Goonies.
No Goonies in the host web.
No Goonies in the host web, and no Now You See Me in the app web. These
right.
are two separate environments.
This is probably a good time to bring up one of the limitations of the app model is deploying things like content types and columns and things like that. Doing it in an app will put those declaratively declared assets into the app web, not into the host web.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah. That if you're trying to deploy something out where you want everything hosted inside the app and you do that declaratively, it's unfortunately not going to work. It's going to put all of that into the app web and not into the host web. Programmatically, you could go in and make the appropriate calls, but declaratively, you're not going to be able to do that.
Yeah, I think that's really important, right? Because
yeah.
So one of the questions that was brought up on the chat was, when I uninstall an app, what happens? And they also subsequently said, does all my app data go? And so if you're sticking things in the app web, then when you uninstall your app, that web gets axed, deleted, and anything you put in it goes away.
Right.
And so it's important to note that if you're storing data in your app web, then that will go away with it when it's deleted. So you've got to make the call. Is this data I want to have stick around? In which case, either put it in the host web
mm-hmm.
by using the CSOM to post into the host, into a list in the host, or in provider-hosted apps, this is not the case if you're storing the data on the back end. Your
right.
data stays on the back end, your app web goes away, but you can still keep the data on the back.
Exactly, exactly. It's an X app. That app is deceased.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Cool. Well, there is, he said, pausing for dramatic effect just long enough so we could kick back to slides over here. There we go, and yeah, there we go. Okay, that was our little demo. So here was the whole goal. The whole goal of that entire module was really to focus in on the basics of going in, creating a host-based app, and once again highlighting the fact that this builds on top of skills that you already have. So with that, what do you say we go ahead, take a little break, and then we'll come on back and take a look at dealing with apps that are not going to be SharePoint hosted, but rather hosted by a remote server.
Sounds good. Are you cool with 5 minutes and we'll be back?
We got to do 10.
10 minutes it is. All right.
All right. We'll be back in 10.